his holy place, God unites those who dwell in his house. He himself gives might and strength to his people. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Friends, we gather today on the 17th Sunday of Ordinary Time. We will conclude the series of parables that we've had for the past 3 weeks. So we will continue to invite our Lord into the mystery that so often humbles us and yet draws us into the kingdom of God. So brothers and sisters, let us call to mind our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries.
Lord Jesus, your mighty God and Prince of Peace, Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Lord Jesus, your Son of God and Son of Mary, Christ have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Lord Jesus, your word made flesh and splendor of the Father, Lord have mercy.
God, have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest. On earth, peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world. Receive our prayer.
You
seated at the right hand of the Father. Have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ. With the Holy Spirit, and the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. O God, protector of those who hope in you, without whom nothing has firm foundation, nothing is holy, bestow in abundance your mercy upon us and grant that with you as our ruler and guide, we may use the good things that pass in such a way as to hold fast even now to those that ever endure. For our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the first book of Kings. The Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream at night. God said, "Ask something of me, and I will give it to you." Solomon answered, "O Lord, my God, you have made me your servant, king, to succeed my father David. But I am a mere youth, not knowing at all how to act. I serve you in the midst of the people whom you have chosen, a people so vast that it cannot be numbered or counted. Give your servant, therefore, an understanding heart to judge your people and to distinguish right from wrong. For who is able to govern this vast people of yours?" The Lord was pleased that Solomon made this request, so God said to him, "Because you have asked for this, not for a long life for yourself, nor for riches, nor for the life of your enemies, but for understanding so that you may know what is right, I do as you requested. I give you a heart so wise and understanding that there has never been anyone like you up to now. And after you, there will come no one to equal you." The word of the Lord. Responsorial song, "Lord, I love your commands."
Lord,
I have said, O Lord, that my part is to keep your words. The law of your mouth is to me more precious than thousands of gold and silver pieces.
Lord,
let your kindness comfort me. According to your promise to your servants, let your compassion come to me that I may live, for your law is my delight.
Lord,
for I love your commands more than gold, however fine, Therefore, I observe them. The revelation of your word sheds light, giving understanding to the simple.
Lord, I love your commandments.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, we know that all things work for the good of those who love God. We are called according to his purpose. For those he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, so that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those he predestined, he also called. And those he called, he also justified. And those he justified, he also glorified. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Blessed are you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have revealed to little ones the mysteries of the kingdom.
Alleluia, alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And
a reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, "The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure buried in a field, which a person finds and hides again. Out of joy, goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant searching for fine pearls. When he finds a pearl of great price, he goes and sells all that he has and buys it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net thrown into the sea, which collects fish of every kind. When it is full, they haul it ashore and sit down and put what is good into buckets. What is bad, they throw away. Thus it will be at the end of the age. The angels will go out and separate the wicked from the righteous and throw them into the fiery furnace, where there will be wailing and grinding of teeth. Do you understand these things?" They answered, "Yes." And he replied, "That every scribe who has been instructed in the kingdom of heaven is like the head of a household who brings from his storeroom both the new and the old." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
This weekend, we are concluding, as I said at the beginning of Mass, the series of seven parables in the Galilean ministry portion of Matthew's Gospel. First, of course, just a quick review, we had the parable of the sower, and then last week, the weeds and the wheat, the mustard seed and the yeast, and then finally, this week, the buried treasure, the pearl of great price, and the net catching fish. Now, we've already talked about the general context of these parables, that Jesus is shifting gears to take a new approach after a period of resistance, and that these parables are really as much about forming his disciples and how to respond to this resistance as they are about reaching the broader audience. But let's now zoom in a bit more for a second on the moment when he makes this shift to the parables, and perhaps we might find a picture that really helps us to see even more clearly and understand today's parables in particular more clearly. You see, in this time of resistance, which is reaching a new peak with the arrival of members of his own family to intervene against him, he steps out of the house, the gospel tells us, and he goes apart from the crowd, seemingly to be alone with the Father, as he often does, and he goes out by the shore. And there along the shore, having a quiet moment with the Father, the crowds come and find him. And as they begin to press in on him, he gets in a boat, probably Peter's, to set out a bit from the shore to sit down and teach. This is not the first time that this has happened. The day that he called, Peter and the other fishermen began the exact same way. Crowds pressing in by the shore, and he gets in the boat of this fisherman Simon, now called Peter, and has him set out far enough that he can sit down and teach the people from the boat. That day, when the lesson was over, a miraculous catch of fish happened. And those four fishermen that were with him leave their old lives behind to follow him. We can have moments like this, moments that seem like a miraculous catch of fish. Over time, though, we realize that we don't know the fate of each of those fish. And as the parable of the sower taught, some will receive the seed on rocky ground, others among thorns, others on a hardened, beaten down path. Not all will take root and bear fruit. But still, as the parable of the weeds and the wheat tell us, the sower is not only generous and persistent, but is also patient. And he gives hearts time to grow. And so what we don't yet see in those miraculous catch of fish moments is that the kingdom is like the net of fish in the parable that he closes this whole series of seven on, that gathers in fish of every kind. And in the end, some will follow him into the kingdom, and others will not. But he finds consolation in the fish who do follow him into the kingdom, the ones who recognize that this covenant relationship with the Lord is like a buried treasure, a pearl of great price, worth giving up everything to obtain. As we heard not long before the parables, Jesus finds consolation in his trials not only in the Father, but in these humble, childlike disciples to whom the Father has revealed the mysteries of the kingdom, mysteries hidden from the wise and the learned. And so this week I'd like to introduce you to one such disciple who has brought a lot of consolation, hope, and peace to my heart recently. And because of this, God called him to be a fisher of men, to be a shepherd, our shepherd, yours and mine. I'm talking about Bishop Louis Toka, our new coadjutor bishop, who now assists Bishop Janke in leading our diocese and will eventually succeed him as the next Bishop of Peoria. At his ordination this past Thursday, I was struck by the language of the decree from the Holy Father, the successor of St. Peter, in appointing Father Louis Toka as our new coadjutor bishop. And I'm reciting this from memory, so it may not be exact, but was struck that in the decree that the Holy Father first addressed the humility and discernment that it required of Bishop Janke to request a coadjutor, which enables his successor, as you consider this, that this really enables his successor not only to come assist him even now, right, to ask for help, but also enables his successor to spend time in the diocese, listening and learning, getting to know the diocese, its peoples, and its gifts, and its needs. And so this request really requires humbling himself to work alongside the man who will take his place. It was striking that the document began by praising Bishop Janke for that humility. But then it shifts to address then-Father Toka. And I was so struck by the language. Again, just from memory, it might not be exact, but essentially what was said next was, "So to meet this need, it is to you, beloved Son, that the eyes of the church now turn." Think about that. What power in those words. And yet, such a clear indication of what the kingdom of God really is. The family of God the Father. This beloved Son of God and of the church, called to step forward and lead. But both in the initial introductions made after he was appointed in May by way of video and written articles, but even more so in the chance I had to finally meet him last week on retreat, I've been impressed with the humility of Bishop Lou. He did not strike me as a man who has sought to climb the ladder and obtain power, but a man who sought to walk humbly with his God and to answer the call, even if it requires believing that packing up and moving to Peoria, a land unfamiliar to him, even if not that far away, is a buried treasure, a pearl of great price, worth giving everything up for. I recognize an appropriate holy fear behind his eyes as he takes up this task, which showed forth even more the humility that was further expressed by his efforts to introduce himself to the priests of the diocese, who he's getting to know for the first time, and asking us to embrace him as a brother who comes to serve alongside us, ready for the leadership that that service calls him to, while honestly admitting in his own words that it is something that he will have to grow into. As he seeks to grow into that role, he really assured us his plan is to spend this time as coadjutor listening, learning, and getting to know the diocese. Not just learning the roads, but learning and getting to know the people, and learning where the Spirit is at work. His brief words at the end of the ordination express this as well. As he told us his heart was filled with joy that the Holy Spirit is still at work in his church. The Holy Spirit is, of course, essentially at work, especially in the Mass. And so it was a great joy in getting to know him last week, hearing Bishop Liu speak about the Eucharist as being central to our faith, which is exemplified in his coat of arms, which, by the way, a lot of what I'm sharing is also reflected in his coat of arms, but in which he shared also how daily Mass and discovering daily Mass as a youth, as a young person, was instrumental for him in his growth and his discernment. When he was asked about a favorite saint, he immediately, his mind went to St. John the Baptist, who he says reminds him what the priesthood is about, pointing away from oneself and toward Christ. When asked about his own calling to the priesthood, he shared a bit of his story, again emphasizing in particular that role of discovering daily Mass as a young person. And he summarized it with great humility and simplicity, saying, "I am a priest because I believe God called me to be a priest." I would add that this is also the same reason he is now a bishop, because God called him, and he learned that following the Lord is indeed worth giving up everything. And so, he now seeks to pass that example on to us, with his episcopal motto, "Go make disciples." As I heard him speak on retreat about this motto, "Go make disciples," and the need to keep our focus upon this central mission entrusted to us by Christ, to make disciples of Jesus Christ from all nations, my heart was immediately lifted up with gratitude and with confidence. You may have noticed over the past few years that we have renamed what we have previously would have called ministries or programs in the parish, and we now strive to speak of adult discipleship, youth discipleship, and family discipleship. On the surface, these are just names. We have a long way to go to make this more of a reality, but it speaks of the direction that we are striving to move. And so I am deeply encouraged that God has given us a shepherd after his heart who seeks to guide our diocese in this direction. He summarized this with a beautifully simple but awesome statement as he said, "We are called to make disciples and to remember that this means that we must be disciples ourselves." So finally, I want to offer a brief word as to why it deepens this consolation that is in my heart now at this time. To consider that our diocese now has over us the banner of two episcopal models, that of Bishop Janke and that of Bishop Tilke. In his will is our peace, and go make disciples. And called to be a bishop, Daniel Janke felt called to emphasize the will of God and the need to discover that it is in doing his will that we find peace. As I reflected on this and prayed for him, it occurred to me that this really is exemplified by the humility and the wisdom of asking for a coadjutor. A difficult decision from a man who loves the church, loves the priesthood, loves the diocese, is not anxious to retire, however much his body may be growing tired. But because he knows that our peace is in the Lord's will, he he was able to discern the Lord's will in this moment. I also want to share with you that this motto of Bishop Jahnke brought great consolation and guidance to me in my discernment of the priesthood. It empowered me to say yes to God, but also to recognize that my God loves me more than I love myself, and truly desires to bring peace, fulfillment, and joy to my heart, so I can trust him. In his will is our peace. And this now sits side by side with Go Make Disciples, the motto of Bishop Tilke. Since we have discovered the peace and fulfillment found in doing the Lord's will, that this covenant relationship with the Lord truly is that buried treasure worth digging deep to find, and that pearl of great price worth giving up everything to obtain, we must share this good news. If we have truly known the peace that comes from seeking to do the Lord's will, we must share this gift with others. We must go make disciples. It will require prayer, humility, patience, generosity, and perseverance, but it is worth everything. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, consubstantial of the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our Savior was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son adored and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Beloved sons and daughters of our loving Father, we turn to him with all of our prayers.
Let us pray for our church leaders. May you strengthen in their work and give them the wisdom to serve wisely. We pray to the Lord.
Lord,
let us pray before Adjutant Bishop Louis Tilke as we give this service to the Diocese of Peoria. May the Holy Spirit continue to bless and guide him. We pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for our government officials, may they offer justice and compassion to those they serve. We pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for all of us here, may the Lord grant us peace in our hearts and compassion for one another. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are sick or suffering, may we always protect the weakest among us, especially the unborn. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And let us pray for all those who died. May the Lord welcome them into the joy of his eternal presence. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And now let us pause and pray from our hearts from personal intention. For these special needs, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the freedom and purification of the Church, Saint Michael, your angel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God be with you and come with your prayer, and do the house against the heavenly hosts. By the power of God, trust in the house of Satan, all the evil spirits, who wander through the world seeking the ruins of souls. With loving confidence, Heavenly Father, we entrust all of our prayers to you, trusting in your holy will, for you are good, and your love endures forever. We ask all of these things through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. Accept, O Lord, we pray, the offerings which we bring from the abundance of your gifts, that through the powerful working of your grace, their most sacred mysteries, these most sacred mysteries, may sanctify our present way of life and lead us to eternal gladness through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live and move and have our being. And while in this body we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in paschal mystery. And so with all the angels and saints, we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy Lord,
God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. But through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said a blessing, broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." Similar way the supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing. He gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with St. Louis and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your Pope and Church on earth, your servant Francis, our Pope, Daniel, our Bishop, Louis, his assistant bishop, the order of bishops, and all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you,
In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world, to our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life. Give time and minutes to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. The Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Lamb of God,
you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold, he who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy to choose you to enter under my roof, but only say the words and my soul shall be healed.
Reminder about the current protocol for Holy Communion. If you come forward, please enter the center aisle and watch for the floor markings, which are there to indicate where to stand to allow sufficient space for those around you. Please come forward single file and then split to go to either sides of the altar rail where distribution of Holy Communion will take place, with the exception of those in the Mother's Chapel and those who are disabled. We also ask that there at the altar rail, that you have the choice to either stand or kneel, as well as when you make that choice, that you might want to remember that there is only a pad on one side, the St. Louis or St. Joseph side. And then also we will be able to frequently purify and sanitize our hands. As you come forward, please sanitize your hands, wear your mask, as we will be wearing ours, and then you can simply pull the mask up or down to receive our Lord and then place it. Lastly, please remember that the bishop is asking everyone accepting extraordinary circumstances to receive on hand only.
Thank you.
my Jesus, I believe that you are present in the Blessed Sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire you in my soul. Whether or not I can now receive you sacramentally, commonly, spiritually, into my heart, as though you were already there, I embrace you and unite myself fully to you. Permit not that I should ever be separated from you. Amen. Let us pray. Assume, O Lord, this divine sacrament, the perpetual memorial of the passion of your Son. Grant, we pray, that this gift which he himself gives us, with love beyond all telling, may profit us for salvation through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
So a few heads up. First of all, the Knights will be selling sweet corn this weekend, so I encourage you to look for them out in the parking lot on your way out. Also, remember this Thursday, we have one more Thursday in which Mass will be moved to 7 a.m. and then the afternoon Holy Hour of Confessions will be canceled. Last week it was because I was traveling down to the ordination. This time it is for the First Communion Mass, which will be taking place that evening. So please also keep our children and their families in your prayers. After the 11:30 Mass tomorrow, I encourage all youth, all young people in the parish are welcome to join us outside for one last game, socially distant, of course, with Kaylee, who has given us so much as our youth coordinator for the past 2.5 years. So we hope you can join us. And on a similar note, this Wednesday, we also have another youth Eucharistic Adoration Night for anyone going into grades 8 through 12. We had a great turnout this past week, so let's do it again. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go forth and ask
you. Thanks be to God.